We tend to think of the extinction of a species in terms of the biological. A planet presents the conditions that it does, which are often very complex and highly situational. And those conditions provide niches for evolution to work and develop specialized species to exploit them. But as we see with Earth, once those conditions change sufficiently, it results in the extinction of a species. No niche, no organism. Extinction is so prevalent that 99% of the species on Earth that ever existed are now extinct. From the trilobites to the dinosaurs, once greatly successful species lost their niche, whether through a violent extinction event or a subtle change in climate that simply rendered them unviable. Here one moment, gone the next, as the last member of a species dies off. This may or may not happen to us, but the reality is that our technology allows us to stave off extinction, such as our ability to deflect asteroids, but at the same time doesn't yet constitute an ability to cause our own extinction. We can end civilization with our technology, but there are only a few ways we can actually go extinct right now, and none of them are at our own hands, and none are very likely. We can drastically contract our population, for sure, but only if everyone on Earth agreed to not reproduce could we accomplish it intentionally. Our numbers are just too large at present. That said, there are several suspected instances in human history where we may have come close to extinction, and now one instance where, had it unfolded just a little bit worse, we would not have gone extinct, rather Homo sapiens would have never existed at all. This event sits in the very distant past, about 1 million years ago, and only recently has come to light through genetic studies. At about this time, the ancestors of modern humans may have undergone a very severe population contraction. Bottlenecks in human genetics are common. It simply occurs when an isolated population of humans undergoes a contraction in numbers, which in turn lowers genetic diversity. One in particular happened about 60,000 years ago, as humans were moving out of Africa. To this day, the African continent shows much greater genetic diversity than any other continent because of this. Contractions are also noted in Polynesian groups much more recently as they settled the islands of the Pacific. In this much more ancient potential bottleneck, however, things apparently got very bad for quite a while. About 930,000 years ago, there were four species of human that we know of: Homo heidelbergensis, Homo antecessor, Homo rhodesiensis, and Homo bodoensis. And we don't know two things about that. First, we don't know from which one we descend, and it's uncertain whether several of them are actually different species from each other. But this bottleneck would have affected the one we descend from. The bottleneck is a very new finding and unfortunately suffers from the problem that the further back you go, the harder it is to determine these kinds of genetic bottlenecks. But there may be some corroborating evidence in that hominid fossils from this period are very, very rare. And the conditions due to climate may have been subject to severe drought in Africa and to an extent Eurasia. This lack of fossils may have been due to there simply being not very many hominids around at the time. But at the same time, other evidence of habitation in Europe don't seem to corroborate the scarcity of the fossils. The genetic evidence, however, is shocking in that we very nearly went extinct before we even existed. The evidence points to the breeding population of our ancestor hominid during the bottleneck diminishing to just 1,300 individuals, less than 2% of what's thought the population of hominid ancestors at the time was. With a high population and technology, extinction is hard, but with a low population, especially that low, extinction is just a step away for any species. If this bottleneck did happen, there's an oddity within it that it may explain. All of our primate relatives, such as the chimpanzees and gorillas, have 24 chromosomes. We have 23. At one point, two chromosomes fused. This is thought to have occurred right about this same time, and may also have had something to do with this bottleneck. But there are other ways to arrive at that result without a bottleneck, so the research remains controversial. But it does illustrate something. It was luck that allowed us to be here. Had that bottleneck, or any of the several severe suspected bottlenecks in human history, just been a little bit worse than they were, then there never would have been a human technological civilization on Earth. This does not bar other species from eventually becoming technological, however. We just made it first. But in a million years or more, it may have ended up dominated by a technological non-hominid, such as a dolphin or octopus civilization. Or maybe not. Maybe some other factors in human development that led to us are not present for many other species. Thus, the solution to the Fermi paradox here is actually a rather pragmatic one. It's just that intelligence is rare simply because extinction is so prevalent, and that the ancestors of what might someday become a civilization short-circuited by dying out more often than not. After all, it took a million years to get from that hypothesized bottleneck to us, and in that time, anything could have happened. And had it happened during a bottleneck, we may not be here. Likewise, movements towards civilization and intelligence may happen commonly in the universe, but it rarely gets there because of the delicate balances needed in nature to maintain a specialized species, living in an evolutionary niche that get upset too often and extinction occurs. Earth got lucky by providing just enough stability over just enough time for it to result. But now that we are here, we face a new challenge, that of the suspension of evolution and the advancement of technology. As technology progresses, biological evolution may stop occurring because the pressures that drive it are mitigated. And with a full command and power over genetics itself, then a civilization becomes the force of evolution and guides it. You can make a human naturally, but you also in principle can create one from scratch by building a genome. But herein also lies the potential for a technological singularity, something that some suspect we're already in. In some ways, technology does not appear to be progressing at an exponential breakneck speed, at least not any longer. But in other ways, such as AI, it is. And with AI may come better, more efficient ways to develop technology, as Ray Kurzweil has written. The whole thing could very quickly become incomprehensible. That said, I'm not sold on the idea myself, and I think at some point we may apply the brakes. But it does get into the potential for humanity to transition from biology to technology, until eventually we exist as a machine civilization. This may or may not happen. We could just as easily choose not to go down that path, and simply continue to use our technology to improve the human condition, the key word being human. But say for a moment it did, or an alien civilization chose to go full-on machine. What changes are in that in regards to extinction? The first change is that the transition between biology and machine may represent an extinction event. If biological humans ceased to exist, and were all downloaded into robots, then Homo sapiens went extinct flat out. So that's level one. But machines may actually be subject to extinction events that we currently are not. A big one that comes to mind are things like solar flares. You can shield against that sort of thing, and move into space away from dangerous stars and other things. But if you were on a planet and you hadn't prepared for a flare, you could EMP yourself out of existence if you have no method of self-repair. Likewise, if you couldn't head out into space, you're still subject to your star's death in the end. And if you somehow can't produce enough energy to keep your machine civilization going, then you don't simply return to a simpler biological existence. Rather, you go extinct. If technology ended tomorrow, humans would see a massive population contraction, but full extinction is unlikely. The population would just drop until there was no one left but those familiar with how to survive through farming, hunting, and the basics that got humans where we are in the first place. In the end, pun intended, it may be that machine civilizations are subject to more extinction possibilities than biological ones are. And it may get weird. One potential issue with true generalized artificial intelligence is that we're not sure how it's going to think. Humans are not computers and computers are not humans. And if they merge, there's no guarantee they'll think the same way they did before the merger. There are many scenarios there. It could launch itself into space, not seeing any reason to hang around with humans. It might become the all-powerful god emperor of the biologicals and all the other tropes. But there's one other option. It may choose extinction on a voluntary basis. There's no guarantee that AI or uploaded humanity will see a point to existence. We do, but we have all these fight or flight and self-preservation instincts. But a computer may have none of that, and just decide that existence is simply too much trouble, and being in a permanent off mode might be preferable. This is especially the case if it came to the realization that there was something out there in the depths of space worse than existence. And the choice is between intentional extinction on its terms, or a war with another machine civilization it can't win that results in extinction not on its terms. And that too is a solution to the Fermi paradox. All biological civilizations become machine civilizations, and conclude that rather than resistance is futile, like the cyborgs might say, instead, it's existence that is futile. But within this is an interesting idea. And since it's spooky October, I'll go full on science fiction author for a moment and present a final thought. Ultimately, life, whether biological or machine, is ultimately a matter of data, genetic or digital. If a machine civilization decides to go extinct, but its data can be recovered by another civilization, it could be brought back in a form of digital de-extinction. This also works for biology, in that if you've got the DNA of something extinct, you can bring it back, or rebuild it from the ground up. So what does that really mean? When toward the end of the universe, when there may be many advanced civilizations, does extinction itself even matter? And might a humanity that went extinct millions of years before be brought back by someone else and live again? Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently highly concerned about the future aliens discovering Halloween in an archaeological dig. Yes, the extinct humans used to celebrate this holiday, and so shall we. And it's a bunch of aliens wearing human masks, yelling boo at each other, consuming various sugars, and the pumpkin is the subject of de-extinction and becomes the representative of Earth and the galactic community. Not sure how I feel about that. And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.